Today I've got 10 pro tips to get you editing video faster and with more precision in DaVinci Resolve 17. And to kick it off, did you know that you can edit your selects from a source timeline by hitting Command Page Up to cut those gems directly down into your super awesome creative sequence? This uses a command under the timeline menu called Swap Timeline and Source Viewer. And you'll also want to go under the Edit menu and turn on Decompose Compound Clips and enable Stack Timelines to tab them and quickly see which sequences that you're toggling. Pretty cool, eh? No clicking and dragging and taking up too much UI space like the pancake method. Even if you're a seasoned pro, I'm willing to bet I've got some rare tips in this video that you haven't used before, and they'll speed up your workflow. So let's go ahead and dive in deep. Just a heads up, we're going through a lot of keyboard shortcuts today, and I'm on a Mac, so if you're using Windows, you'll have to do a little translation, like Command to Control or Option to Alt. And I also have timestamps down below, so feel free to skip around to a new tip that you could use. Shuffle lets you change the order of clips on the timeline without using cut and paste or some sort of funky moving around of all the clips on the timeline to make space. What I mean by making more space is, let's say we want this lime clip to come right after the green clip here on the timeline. A lot of people would select everything on the timeline, they'd move it over so there's a gap there. They'd move this up and then they'd move this across with their mouse, maybe move it like that, then have a couple gaps to close up. That's a lot of steps. That's unnecessary steps that you don't need to do because we have swap and shuffle edits. The way we use those, it's really simple. We just need to select the clip. The fastest way to do that is with Shift V on the keyboard. That selects the clip under the playhead, and then using Command Shift, comma, or period. So comma is on the left side of the keyboard, it goes to the left. Period is on the right, goes to the right. So Command Shift, comma, moves it, and it swaps everything else out of its place. Look at that. You can go up and down the timeline with a clip super, super fast that way. And it goes a step beyond that. You can even select multiple clips on your timeline. They'll keep the order of those clips you've selected, and then you can try those out in a different area. It's kind of like Final Cut Pro's, the way the connected clips and compound clips work in there. So if I use Command Shift on here now, it's moving those three as a bundle sort of together, which is really handy. And then finally, I want to show you with swap and shuffle edits is that you can do this with the mouse as well. You can click and drag with using Command Shift. So the one thing I want to warn you about is make sure you have snapping turned on. It's this button right here. It's also N on the keyboard to toggle it on and off. This way you don't accidentally trim a head or tail of a clip without realizing what you're doing. So if we hit Shift V to select that clip again, and then I hit Command Shift on the keyboard to click and drag, we can see it's going to snap right to a different section. And this would actually let you split up part of a clip that's right next to it if you needed to. So that is swap and shuffle edits here in DaVinci Resolve 17. Super cool, unique feature. Did you just download a music track and you need to spot it in your timeline real quick? Check this out. Throughout the editing process, you're always getting new clips in, and you can actually go straight from the Finder to the timeline. But first, I want to make sure that I have opened the bin I want the footage to go into. So I clicked my music bin here. I hit Command Tab to go to my Finder, and I can just click and drag this music clip that I just downloaded. Command Tab to go back over to Resolve, and we see we've got the music track on the sequence. We didn't do anything except for drag it from the Finder to the timeline, and it's organized in the bin that we had specified. Replace Edit aligns both of your playheads to edit in sync with each other with a single command. So here's a timeline. I've got paper tearing out of it. We need to hear that paper being torn. So that's what we're going to use Replace Edit for. It's this button right over here. F11 is the shortcut. A lot of people think they use that to replace a shot. Some people do, but I think there's a better tool called Ripple Overwrite, which we'll get to later in this video. So we're actually going to be using it just to sync up the sound. Let's go back here to the clip. We're going to find the frame that the paper starts to be torn, which is right there. And then we're gonna go to our source, which has the sound effect. You hit Q to get up there, and we can see Q toggles between our source and record side. So Q again gets us over there. And to preview it, let's go home and then L to playback. It sounds good, but we need to find the very beginning frame. I'm hitting J to go backwards, and I can't actually hear it as I'm using my arrow keys. That's because audio scrubbing is not turned on. Hit Shift S to hear audio scrubbing. And now we can start to hear the beginning of that. Right there, that was the beginning of the sound of the paper tearing. We're gonna just hit F11. That's gonna do a replace edit, which is actually just gonna put it straight down on our timeline where we have it patched over here. We have it going to A1. And now it should be in perfect sync and it should sound amazing. We can hit L on the keyboard to play it. And it sounds, looks good. And if we wanna perfect it or look further, you can mark the clip with X and you can, play in to out with option question mark. And you can even loop it if you wanted to, but that gives you the idea of replace edit. It's just simply match your timeline with your source and the playhead positions, and it's gonna put it exactly where you want it. So it's so good for sound effects. Fit to fill is a great way to automatically change the speed of your source clips to fit a music segment on your timeline. So with fit to fill, you know we're getting more advanced because there are no fit to fill buttons over here. You need to know the command, and now you know it. It's Shift F11, okay? And the way you use it is you need 4 points marked. You need the source and record marked. It's only 4-point edit that I know of, so let's find a place on the timeline we want to use fit to fill. So let me play this music track. I'll mark I and O on the fly with I. All right, there was a section that I liked, and let's drop this time-lapse clip of the PCH on here. Let's say we want to start here, so an I there, O there, Shift F11, and it has automatically retimed that clip. It has sped it up. We know there's a little odometer there, little speed change indicator, and we can say change clip speed, and it went to 173% of the original speed. So it sped it up, super helpful, handy. Let's get a couple more clips on here because I want to show you a couple things that you might want to watch for. Let's go here. Okay, so we got another bar of music that we're gonna be putting our new clip on. Let's do this typing one. Now you'll notice this typing one, it has a little music note there. It means there's sound associated with it. We can also tell that because down here, it has automatically turned on this A1 indicator. Now if I put this down on the timeline directly right now, it's gonna overwrite my music. The way you avoid that is you uncheck this target selection. Okay, so now that's turned off, I can hit F11. And we just get the video portion of the clip on there, which is what we want. We can preview it. And he is typing furiously. I wish I could type that fast. And then one other thing that I think is super useful to know about fit to fill is it's a great thing to use whenever you, let's mark another section while I'm talking. It's great to use while you are, you know, to have like a GoPro clip or a drone clip, like this drone clip. It's super, super long, but maybe I want to cover a lot of ground in a short amount of time, which is kind of what I'm doing with this tutorial here. I'm trying to cover a lot of ground in a short amount of time. So mark an endpoint there. This is Lake Dillon, not far from where I am. And if I hit Shift F11, that gets us that whole section in just a short amount of time. And so I think you can clearly see how useful fit to fill could be for your workflow. This can also work in other directions. You can use this to slow down clips as well. I just find I'm usually have really long clips a lot and I need to get them in shorter videos and short amount of times, commercials and stuff. So that's what I use fit to fill for. Hopefully you'll enjoy that one. Hey, I'm calling a timeout real quick because we're halfway there. I'm Chadwick and I want to welcome you if you're new here. This is Creative Video Tips. It's all about helping you create videos that make a difference and stand out. So if you're into making better videos, click subscribe right down below right now. Go ahead. It's free. There's no contract required. That way you won't miss out on the new tip next week. And maybe hit the bell thing too while you're down there. All right, let's get back at it with the fastest way to knock off unwanted tops and tails of clips. I'm super excited to share this one with you. If you haven't learned it already, it's tops and tails, trim start, trim end. And what it lets you do is every clip starts with junk at the beginning and junk at the end that we want to get rid of, right? So a lot of times people would go through here, they'd hit Command B, they'd select it, and then they'd hit delete on the keyboard. Then you got a gap to clean up, or maybe you were clever and you knew I want to use the other delete and it ripples it for you. Well, this saves the step of even having to hit the blade button. What you're going to be doing is hitting the shift brackets. So shift left bracket, shift right bracket. Left bracket takes the left side of the clip, right and the right side. I think that makes sense, right? So all we're going to do is go over here with this playhead right at the beginning of this line that's about to be said. And I'm going to hit shift left bracket and it tidies everything up. Now it didn't ripple. And the reason it didn't ripple is because we're in the selection mode. If we go to trim mode, which is T on the keyboard to get there, and then go to it, it's gonna ripple and tidy up the sequence as we go. So if I hit shift right bracket, it shortens it up. Now I can take this a step further and actually stay in the arrow selection mode if you wanted to, which is A, and just use a modifier. So instead of using shift left and right bracket, we're gonna add command to that, and it basically kind of temporarily puts us in the trim mode that's gonna ripple it for us. So let's say we go to this clip right here, we wanna get rid of all of this stuff, which was what obviously it was like a mistake or something. I would hit command shift left bracket, and it shortens it up like that. We go to the right, Command Shift right bracket. You can see how quickly you could go through a lot of takes real quick and shorten them up so you're not wasting time when you're reviewing. Like in this instance, I was trying to figure out which take is going to be the best or which, you know, you can compare, you know, lines really quickly when you clean things up. And this is a good way to do it. It's also a great way if you have a really long talking head, even like a YouTube video where you might just want to go through and just, you know, get down to the basics really quickly, and you don't need to mark ins and outs. You don't need to use blade tools at all. You start with one blade, and then you can just keep going, trim start, trim end, all the way down, tops and tails. It's a lot of fun. I can't wait for you to use this one. Extend Edit is a great way to trim up several layers of video clips to end at the same point. So I love to use Extend Edit to pull out. What I mean by that is I've got a series of graphics here that are all stacked up, and I want them all to end at like the exact same point. Like, what if I want them all to end right at 6 seconds? What I would do is grab the trim tool, which is this guy over here. It's T on the keyboard. And then you can marquee the ends, the tails of these clips. By dragging that, it highlights them all green. And then Extend Edit command is E. It's just E. So hit E once, and now everything is lined up right at that 6 second mark. So this is great if you have lots of stuff that's stacked to, and you need them all ending at the same time, that's what you would want to use. You can make things shorter here by hitting E right there, or longer, and pull out further with Extend Edit that way. But the main thing is you need to select the edges, and the quickest way to do that is with the trim tool and just dragging a marquee on what you want extended like that. So Match Frame is extremely powerful when you're working to find those last little nuggets that your video needs. It calls up the current timeline clip in your source monitor. Match Frame is like having the fastest assistant in the world go find a piece of footage for you in the bin when you've already cut it out of your timeline. What I mean by that is I've got a segment here where I have a statement that gets cut off maybe a little early. Maybe there's more information that I could get more into the video. I would listen to it. Let's see what she says.
I believe there's right and there's wrong. So forgiveness for...
I believe there's right and there's wrong. What did she actually say after that when we actually filmed the interview? What we need to do is use Match Frame. Match Frame is F on the keyboard. But the thing is it obeys these auto track selectors over here. So because that is turned on for track two and the playhead's going to go top down, it's going to match frame to this clip right here, this B-roll clip, not the A-roll clip that's underneath it. So if I temporarily turn that off, it's disabled now. Now I'm match framing back to that original clip. The other thing you can always do if you don't want to be messing with these, which you have to be mindful that you'll lose sync sometimes if you're not paying attention to those, because that's what keeps your sync, is you can leave that on and you can option double click. And then that's another way it pulls up to match frame here in the monitor. It just also opens up my media pool, which I wanted that closed for real estate purposes. But that's open now. Now, if I want to hear and sort of see the audio waveforms, there's a little three-dot button menu up here, and we'd say show zoomed audio waveforms, so we can hear.
There's wrong, and there's good, and there's bad.
And she says, and there's good and there's bad. Well, I want to add that into the video to get more clarity. You go back down to the timeline with Q. You can go to the next edit with the down arrow, and then you can hit F9 to insert it. As simple as that. It could not just go right there. It could go anywhere in the video, but now we've given a little more clarity.
I believe there's right and there's wrong and there's good and there's bad.
There's right and there's wrong. There's good and there's bad. There's a little more context there. So that was a good use of match frame. You could also use this for B-roll really easily. So maybe we like this B-roll shot quite a bit and we want to see what is around it, you know? We can hit F to call that up there in our source viewer. And now we have the entire source clip available. See, this is like super, super long to try to find other B-roll segments from when the camera operator had start and stopped recording. Well, I don't trim in Source Monitor very often. It's good to know how it's different from Match Frame. This will actually perform trims on your timeline from the Source Monitor instead of just pulling up your original clips for you to hunt around. Trim in Source Monitor looks and feels a lot like Match Frame, but it is totally different. The way you access it is you double-click a clip on the timeline, and it loads it into Source. Now, because we had double-clicked instead of option double-clicked or clicked F, any change you do here with in and out points is reflected on the timeline. So this could be good or bad, but in this instance, let's say we want the moment when the typewriter starts coming into frame right there, we mark an I, you'll see that it has changed it on the timeline, and it has left the gap because we're in the edit selection mode, not in trim mode. So if I were to undo that and do that again in trim mode, select it, and then I came up here and hit I, now you can see it made the timeline shorter. So just know that that's a difference between match frame, which is a totally different thing than trim and source monitor. The other thing though, if you get into using trim and source monitor, all the power to you, you can hold down shift up here and hold shift to drag your in and out points, and it actually does a slip there on the timeline, which is really actually pretty cool. So that's one way you can kind of scan with your mouse by holding shift on the keyboard and clicking and dragging. It does the slip for you. Now, of course, if you get into the more basic tutorial that I'll probably have on this, if you go to trim mode, you can just slip right here on the timeline. And I think that's a little bit more intuitive, or of course the speed editor. But that is basically trim and source monitor. Don't get that confused with match frame, which is F, which is how you're gonna find all those little nuggets and then drop them in anywhere you want. And Ripple Overwrite does the old trading spaces trick to replace the old clip with the new clip using the new clip's length. What's great about Ripple Overwrite, other than the fact that it actually lives on the speed editor, I've got a lot of tutorials on this if you're interested in learning about it, but it replaces the clip with the new clip's duration. So on the timeline here, I've got a wide typewriter shot and a close-up typewriter shot. The close-up typewriter shot, if I hit X, we can see this is actually 4 seconds long. And the one I want to replace it with is this sort of obscure angle, and this is 6 seconds long. So it's going to use this duration of the in and out that I had marked right there and get rid of this at the same time. So I can get rid of those marks there on my timeline with Option X. I can come back up here and hit the Ripple Overwrite command, which is going to be Shift F10. F10 is Overwrite. Ripple Overwrite, which changes the duration, is Shift F10. So just hit Shift F10. And we can see it got rid of the shot that's down there on the timeline without putting any marks on it. It's just based off of where the playhead was, and it made it longer. So that's a really, really handy tool to try out different shots on your timeline and have everything else kind of push out of the way. Now, if you learned anything new from this video today, make sure to give it a like or share it so more people can find out how cool Resolve is. Click right up here for more DaVinci Resolve tutorials, and since there's so much more to learn, I'll see you in the next video.